presentation on Inclusive Internship Initiative by Courtney Miner, Zeta Delgado, and Joanna Kolosov, and Sarah Van Treese, if she's around. Oh, she's up there. Okay. Anyway, welcome.
Thank you very much. We appreciate this opportunity, commissioners and library staff and public, to be able to talk to you about Sonoma County Library's participation in the Public Library Association's Inclusive Internship Program. And just to say a little bit by way of introduction of what that is, it was a grant to fund summer internships at 50 libraries across the country, sponsoring juniors and seniors in high school, recent graduates, to participate in a connected learning project. And so what is connected learning? It is an initiative, a framework that's being promoted by the American Library Association within libraries and has particularly driven this internship program. It's learning that occurs at the intersection of personal interests, relationships, and opportunities. And by personal interest, we mean that the project is driven by the personal interests of the intern in this case. Which obviously helps maintain interest and attention over the long term, and also foster deeper learning. The relationships piece has to do with the involvement of mentors, as well as the intern's interaction with their peers. Courtney was able to be a member of a cohort of 50 teens across the country, so that's been a very useful aspect of this internship. And the last part about opportunities is really tangible, real-world experience that's sort of career-driven, as well as community interest-driven. And so Zaida will follow and say a little bit more, and Courtney will explain the details of the project.
Okay, so we, Joanna and I worked as co-mentors to Courtney throughout her time with us, which was a really valuable experience and a really unique experience for history and genealogy staff, since Joanna and I are both librarians and we're both archivists. We bring that kind of unique experience that only history and genealogy could really provide. And kind of that role that we really took upon ourselves is, how can she get an understanding of what public libraries do, but then understand the unique position that archives play in documenting the communities that we serve, and how can public libraries and archives collaborate, and how can we impact the community in a significant way? So we wanted her to, at the bare minimum, leave with an understanding of librarianship and of archives, and to be able to understand the difference.
So, good evening. I'm Courtney. I was the intern here at H&G for the summer. And as Zaida mentioned, there was this intersection and this collaborative intersection between public libraries and special collections libraries in particular. But I believe it all comes back to this idea of community and what that means to the community and to each individuals within that community. So one of the earliest, I guess, assignments that they had me do was read through the Archivist Corps documents. I read through that, I annotated it like a good student, and one phrase that really stuck out for me was authentic documentation. And so in the context of history and genealogy, they asked me what I thought that meant, and here I am 2 months later with a much more thorough understanding of what that meant. At the time, back in June, I had an idea, I kind of pulled something out of the air as they were asking me, put on the spot a little bit, but I now know that authentic documentation is getting it directly from the source. No third parties, no mediation, no coverage, no fibbing, no anything fluffy, just hearing the story, hearing the authentic story from that person. And so I took that and turned it inwards with personal interest. And I said, well, what am I interested in? And my mom, she's very involved in the community. And I looked at that, and I looked at authentic documentation, and I realize that you look at some of the historical records of this county, and there are a lot of voices that are missing. There are a lot of perspectives that aren't considered. And as Joanna mentioned, the project that she was working on is Native American documentation, because we have the tribes here in Sonoma County, but let the history records tell them, and they aren't as prevalent as they truly are. And so, but a lot of the documentation that we do have on them is research that other people did on their behalf. They saw that there was a gap in the history record, so they went and did the research and gathered the sources and all these things and created something speaking for the Native Americans. And so with that in mind, I came up with my Sonoma County By Our Own Hand project. The By Our Own Hand, it kind of comes from the phrase for us, by us, which goes back to authentic documentation. Like, we all have our stories and our experiences and our perspectives and our lives that deserve to be shared and deserve to be archived and deserve to be documented. And so my targeted age group was teenagers, because it's a group I know best. I figured I knew how I would be able to figure out how to kind of not necessarily manipulate them into participating, but Zyda specializes in outreach. And so with the mind of a teen, I figured I'd be pretty solid on outreaching towards those teenagers. And so I had a website and I had an Instagram. Social media and digital conversation is very effective with teens. Obviously, we're always on our phones. So the Instagram was primarily used to publish the information and get it out to people and send people the posters and flyers and that kind of direct outreach. And you could tag people, and I was following them. And so when I posted, they saw it. And it was kind of the primary communication method or platform. And then the website was ideally where everything would live. It was where they would first come to receive the information that they were looking for, to get an idea about the project, to look at other submissions from other teenagers. And the very one of the pages on the website, and you can see on the left side that you see the different pages that the website contains, but one of the very first pages that I constructed for the site was a project statement, as one of our core values was transparency, because I think in something such as asking someone to tell their story and share their past, that's a very vulnerable place that you're putting someone in, and I wanted people to understand that we weren't trying to do anything under the table, we weren't trying to hide anything, we weren't trying to steal their content. And so transparency, I made that clear. And with the other values, which is recognition of the past, cultural solidarity, and impactful representation, I wanted it all out there, because I think that's another key component to making sure that everything in this county is authentically documented, that everything is stated and it's clear and there's no covering up and there's no making it up and no one has to question anything, because it's there and it's authentic and it's to the point. And at the top, it mentions who the project was intended for, what the intention was. On the grounds of inclusivity, everyone was welcome to submit, but like I mentioned, the targeted age group was teens, because I like to think that our teenagers are pretty active here in the county, and so I wanted to hear those stories and hear those voices. So I'm in ArtQuest at Santa Rosa High, or I was, I graduated in May, and so as a creative person, again, going back to personal interests, I wondered, well, what's something that I would be interested in, what's something I could work on all summer? So I geared it towards creativity, and basically the premise of the project is that you look inward at your life and your identity and your communities and your cultures and just you as a person within the greater narrative and the greater community, and you say, well, what is within me that I want someone else to hear? What is within me that I want someone to remember? And in the future, if there was someone else like me, what would I want them to see in me to empower them and help them and encourage them? And so basically I invited teenagers to write something, create something, a poem, a song, a dance, a poster, whatever they know how to make that tells them, tells their identity. And it was called the By Our Own Hand Project. You can see we have the Instagram, and the one on the right is the first post that we made. It's in both English and Spanish, as was the entire website, and as much of the content that I put out as I could manage to have in both languages, again, on the ground of inclusivity. The top middle is the flyer that I made. I had sent that out at the very beginning with an email asking some teen service librarians to help us with our outreach. And the bottom picture is from Friday, I attended a Pride Teen Book Club in Roanoke Park, and I did a little presentation there. And yeah, that was really fun. I was really glad I got to do that. I met with these other two people from another program, LGBTQ Connection of Sonoma and Napa, I think. And they have another event coming up on Wednesday that they invited me to, and I will be attending that. It's kind of a poetry cafe sort of thing. And yeah, this just shows I was trying my best to reach out how I knew how and get out there where I could and just get the information to as many recipients as possible. And here's this last slide. So it says, by our own hand, the greater narrative will not forget us. And that's something that I kind of just came up with, and it became more or less the tagline of the entire project. Obviously, it's the name of the project, but the whole idea of everyone has a power in their own right, and as long as you can use that and hone that and use it how you can, then your voice will be remembered in the greater narrative. And so around this slide, these are some pictures, a couple of submissions that were received and are now on the website from the teens of Sonoma County. And I believe that is everything. Yeah. Any questions? Yes?
I'm just looking at the website. Mm-hmm. And are you going to continue this? Is this going to continue on? Once you put up a website, it never seems to go away. So
Yes. Well, my internship ends this week. Actually, it's the last week. So we have a tentative deadline of August 6th for submissions. And afterwards, we are trying to turn it into a digital collection on our website so that even if it's a Google site, if they decide to take it down or whatever, it'll live on beyond today. But I'm still here for a week and a half or so after the deadline before I leave for college. And I know teens, while they do pull through, they take a long time to do it. So for any stragglers, I'm trying to hold out as long as I can to receive those submissions because we don't want to block off anyone.
That's great. I just wanted to say that this looks like a wonderful project.
And, thank you.
If we can continue it somehow, I would support that, definitely.
Thank you.
Yes, I want to say thank you so much for bringing your very much needed voice into our system. For me personally, bringing in our youth of color, youth of varying abilities, LGBT, the whole bit, very important. So props for throwing your hat in the ring and for all this good work. That was one of my primary questions, which is how will this live on? Mm-hmm. And it sounds like you've already laid down some great, foundation about maybe who can pick this up and continue it on. Mm-hmm. One of the things that has come up through my local lab and my youth lab member is mentorship of some sort. And in particular about how to prepare themselves for college, how to mm-hmm. get jobs, that type of thing. In all of your research and all of your connections, can you foresee a way that this work can also partner with helping youth along those lines, like developing partnerships to get into colleges, to get jobs, those type of things? Do you have any thoughts, inspirational considerations?
Well, if they have the time and it's available next year, I would definitely suggest applying for the internship. For that in itself was a great opportunity. I learned a lot of professional skills because I've never had an official job before because I was really busy with ArtQuest and whatnot. For that, for one, but if you want to get very emotional and philosophical, then I suppose self-reflection and getting in touch with some of the parts of yourself that you don't always want to think about, those are very crucial skills to academic development. Being able, I was a straight A student for years. I got my first B on my report card this year, and I cried for so long. But after I cried, I sat down and said, okay, it wasn't the teacher. She didn't just give me this grade for the sake of it. What did I do? What did I fail to do? And I think that type of self-reflection is really crucial for trying to move on into higher education as well as the professional world. And creativity, I think, is very valuable for these types of environments, which the project promotes in itself. And yeah, does that answer your question? Yeah.
Barbara? Thank you all. Yeah. Thank you to the mentors. Wonderful experience for you as well. And for as a Courtenay.
Yes.
Courtenay. I'm envious. I would have loved to have that experience, you know, as somebody right out of high school. It's just fantastic. I'm wondering, all the work that you put into this, I'm wondering how many submissions you've received. It looks like the deadline is today, although you mentioned the 6th.
Yeah. We've had 10 submissions. Mm-hmm. I've had, like I mentioned, the hard part was people were very interested in that. They expressed that very avidly. But again, teenagers, so the hard part was getting them to buckle down and send in the submission. But I'm proud of what I have done, what we've done together, so 10 submissions right now.
I was wondering if maybe one of the teachers at the high school could, I don't know, carry this forward somehow, like just by encouraging some of their mm-hmm. students in one of the writing classes or one of the classes, you know, to keep posting, and then it should live on. You go through all this, and it's such an interesting concept. And I went to, on Saturday, the library had a distinguished speaker series that finished up on this last Saturday. Mm-hmm. It's a wonderful speaker over in Sonoma. And she was from an Iranian family, moved to the United States, grew up here as a kid during the Iranian Revolution. And somehow she made this funny. I mean, she's just amazing. But she was all about the personal story and mm-hmm. that we all have a story. And it was just, it's so much synergy with what you're talking about. So I agree with the other commissioners who are talking about, it'd be great to carry this forward and not just let it, you know, stop. You've got all the momentum here. Mm-hmm. So I don't know what the ideas are for that, but I'd like to see it continue. Thank you.
Thank you.
And good luck to you in the future.
Thank you.
Jason?
Great job. Quick question. How do you find this? Like, is it on Instagram?
Primarily. And then the Google site is linked in on the Instagram. The Instagram is public. If you look it up, By Our Own Hand Project on Instagram, then you can find it. From there, you find the site and everything else. But
so there's no, I just Googled it, and that's the extent of my ability to search. So you have to go to Instagram to find it, I take it?
Yeah, no. Instagram is a public platform. And
no, I understand that, but it doesn't come up as I just did it. Doesn't come up under a normal search. Mm-hmm. So if something is the landing page, normally like on a Facebook, you could have a landing page that'll come up in a Google search. Is Instagram not the same? How would somebody just, at least, I didn't go in depth on the search, but at least the initial pages. So how would somebody to find this if they don't have an initial?
We've got it in the commission packet right now, the link to the website. I think the last time I searched it on Google, it came up, but it was several pages of scrolling down. In terms of it living longer, we definitely have plans to include all the submissions in Sonoma County Library's digital collections as a collection. So it'll live on in our digital collections. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Thank you.
In terms of being preserved.
I'm gonna go find it.
Yeah, it should be.
All right.
Should be findable.
Deborah?
Great story. This is a wonderful story. And this is just a personal note, but I think that as you move forward with your performing, mm-hmm. this is going to be so important in terms of listening to the real story and putting that in your performance or writing what you decide to do. I think that this is really a remarkable experience. And as you can tell, we're all very jealous that that we didn't do it. So congratulations and best of luck. We hope to hear from you later.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay. I want to thank you very, very much. I did have a couple of thoughts as you were going through. I do know a couple of teachers that might be interested in doing something along this line. So if you want to know them, I'll contact me and I'll give you their names. I also wondered if something like this could be rolled over into an already existing project, something like Listening for a Change or something of that nature. I mean, it's just a thought I'm throwing out. If that could be done, that would be great because it would carry it on. And I think that's really important. And I loved your willingness to look inside yourself and see how you impacted your grade or something else. Mm-hmm. That is a major, major piece to moving forward in life. And I commend you for the strength to do that. So, thank you. Any other comments? Any public comments? Thank you, Courtney.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Moving on, we have an introduction of Eddie Dawson, web programmer analyst. Vicki? Thank you all.
I would like to introduce Eddie Dawson. We are so excited about this new position we have at Sonoma County Library IT Services Division. She's a web programmer analyst, so she's going to be able to add a lot to our website, work with our online library catalog and so forth. And Eddie comes to us from the CSU. And we're really, really lucky because they were going to make all the web programmers for CSU move to Long Beach. And she didn't want to move to Long Beach. She lives in Santa Rosa. So we're just jazzed as can be to have Eddie Dawson. You want to talk for just a second? Press the button. All right.
First, I'd like to say how really happy I am to be here. And it's a great organization. And everyone, and I really believe in the mission, and I'm really glad to be a part of that mission and add my skill set in the best way I can. Anyone?
Hey. Any comments? Barbara?
Well, I'm excited too. Vicki's very excited. I'm very excited. It's going to meet you. I don't know what all it is that you're going to do, but I'm impressed. Thank you. I wanted to say in part of our packet here, there were a lot of comments about our IT. There's a lot of IT stuff in her packet tonight. Somebody mentioned a redo of the whole website, and I'm wondering if you've had a chance, Steve, to look at our website and think it through and whether you think it's at that state or whether you're going to be looking more at additions and modifications.
Well, we do have a plan to move it from Drupal 7 to Drupal 8, and I've already started on that. And
I don't know what that means.
Drupal is an open source content management system that the current website is in. It's in Drupal version 7, and it really needs to move forward to Drupal 8, the next version. And with that, we hope to not only upgrade it to that, but address usability, responsiveness for all devices, more user-friendly in some ways. We want to do some really analysis of what would make it more user-friendly, really concentrate on the things that people really want to see right away. So it'll be a process. We'll probably migrate the site from one version to the other, and then we'll start working on the larger issues of how do we want to represent it.
So will it look a lot different?
Well, I don't know. This is my second week here, and I haven't had a chance to talk to all the stakeholders.
I want to just say that she's done remarkable work in just a little over a week in terms of taking the existing site, moving it to a new hosting system and platform, and she's already rolling. So we are very, very lucky, and we won't be making major changes to the website until we involve multiple stakeholder groups. You can't just say, okay, Eddie, change it all. You know, we've got to work with multiple stakeholder groups, with our branch managers, with the digital branch team, and a number of other sets of folks. So, but the exciting part is that she already sees what we need just to get it to the next version and to move it to a more stable hosting platform.
Stephen.
Yes, I would really encourage us to look into a more stable platform, and I would again urge us to look at what other libraries have done. Again, we do not operate in a silo here. We should be looking for the best practices, the most up-to-date, the most stable platform, and that's what we should shoot for. Thanks.
That's what we're aiming for.
Well, it was nice meeting you, and I apologize for pronouncing your name incorrectly initially.
No worries, my whole life.
I probably won't remember it, but it is Edie.
Okay.
That's me, not you. Anyway, okay, well, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And welcome
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Fun and games.
Is that it?
Okay. The Technology Strategic Plan presentation by Carson Block is up. I'm assuming, since I see the picture on the thing, I'm assuming he is there. Carson, welcome.
I am here. Thank you very much. Can you hear me okay?
No.
A little bit louder.
We're turning up the volume.
Okay, that sounds good. I'll just talk until you just can't stand my voice anymore.
Even I can hear that one.
Yeah, can you hear that okay?
Yes, we can now.
Great. And you're able to see my slides on the screen? And are you also getting my video?
Yep.
Excellent. Well, let's start. This was quite an excellent process that we had. Very, very interesting place that Sonoma Library is at. And what a great time to be invited to be part of the strategic technology plan. You have two documents in front of you. One is the executive summary, and the other one is the full plan. And we needed to give you that. Sometimes we bundle in a strategic technology plan, we'll bundle the executive summary at the front. But in this case, we wanted to have two separate documents because one is quite detailed, as you can see, and gets pretty in-depth. And the other tells more of the bigger story that we want to tell with a strategic plan like this. This is the very first ever strategic technology plan that Sonoma Libraries has had. So we needed to make sure that we did a really good job conveying the key parts of the assessment so that everyone had a sense of where the library is today and why the different transformational pieces were introduced, why some of the specific directions are defined in the plan, just to have a glance of where we're coming from so that we know where we want to go. The focus is on high-level strategic transformation, so we avoided as much as possible from digging into the weeds, even though there's plenty of weeds in there, because we had to follow some tangents. We really wanted to make sure that we were staying in the upper part, the strategic part. And we did give some attention to tactical actions, just to give it some form and to make it expected to say this is where the kind of the bigger picture goes into the more of the specifics. The assessment visioning activities, I was so fortunate to be able to visit twice, but also performed a lot of activities remotely as well. We put together a staff steering group for the process to check in on. Had remote presentations and interviews with different staff groups and different individuals. Did a technology environment survey. Also did a survey of the library administration and management to learn their perspectives on different issues, especially some hot button issues that are at the library in terms of technology. We had on-site focus groups and tours. I did somewhat of a secret shopper sort of experience, and it was wonderful. It was I just had such a great time and left with such a great impression of just how well things are going in so many areas. And we had a lot of other opportunities to talk. Vicki and I worked quite closely during this process, and also was wonderful to be able to work with Anne as she's come on board to work about this. The timing for this plan is extremely important as well because of where you're at in terms of the strategic planning process. Also, in the fact that there's been so many changes, especially recently, that this is a very good time to take every infinite possibility there might be and to put those into one direction, point them in a strategic direction, and do it in a way that brings some order and some efficiency, as well as following vision and putting some things back on there. So we were very cognizant that this is happening right before the renewal of the library's overall strategic plan. So we did our very best to include elements that you may find useful going forward with that. Of course, one thing that had never been done at Sonoma before was giving some thought to a vision and a mission and values. And so working together with the IT department, this is from the IT department's perspective, we came up with what I like to call elements of vision. If anyone has ever gone through a visioning process, you know that there's always a lot of great ideas, and the hardest part is spending all that time trying to make one pithy statement that sums it all up. I think that's too much work. I think what we can do is a lot of times we can identify elements that can work together, elements of vision. The elements of vision from our IT department, as patrons will have access to technologies that inspire and improve and enrich their quality of life. And IT staff have a vision for exceptional customer service and innovation. Now, one thing I want you to notice is that patrons are at the center here. And one of the dangers that happens in a support service like IT is it's very easy to lose sight of the end purpose. And our purpose is patrons. And in fact, that is one of the elements of the IT department mission. Our primary purpose is serving library patrons. And remembering that that's the reason that we are all here working in different capacities in the library. Being patron-centered is a driving and unifying force through support to other library staff in their work for patrons and directly to patrons as well via digital offerings. We have a responsibility to inspire, guide, and support technology choices that are purposeful and impactful for patrons and staff. IT staff build their individual and collective skills daily to support their customer service vision. And finally, on the daily purpose, the elements of the IT department mission, we have a responsibility to be good stewards of library resources by understanding and communicating the financial and human costs of technology and help make the library make technological decisions that offer the deepest impact with the highest value possible. Also, speaking of values, it's a nice transition into that. These values give a sense of the sorts of culture that that exists now in the library IT department, and also ones that we want to make sure that are maintained because they're very powerful. One is that we're curious, exploratory, and open to new technologies and approaches. We view the concept of synergy as a value and not a buzzword. We're partners with other library staff in the delivery of services to patron. We're open, available, and accessible to library staff. We have a strong team camaraderie as IT staff members. That was the first thing I noticed, and that stays with me as I've gone for. Also, something that is rare and welcome, we foster a let's learn together environment between IT staff and between IT staff and other library staffers. We cultivate high competencies in project management, and we also share in building the success of our efforts and support each other when things do not work out as planned. Because if you're doing anything right in technology, you're taking some chances. Not everything works perfectly, and that is a perfectly normal and excellent part of the process. My apologies, I forgot to advance these very colorful very colorful slides. Getting to the heart of the plan, we have three goals that also equate to what is a transformational arc. And the idea of a transformational arc is it shows a deliberate transformation from where the library is now and where it wants to go into the future. And in this case, we've got those wrapped up in goals. And so we have goal one, which is shifting from reactive to proactive. Goal two is building a collaborative technology framework. And goal three is designing and deploying future-forward patron services. Now, you might say, wait a minute, I'm a commissioner for Sonoma Libraries. I know that we're doing a lot of designing and deploying future-forward patron services. That is certainly true. I would say that there is a more powerful way to do that by getting out of the predominantly reactive mode and also building up this collaboration framework among all staff to make this incredibly powerful platform to really do something amazing with patron-forward services. So just very briefly, in shifting from those goals, of course, are interactive. But shifting from a reactive to proactive, one of the things that happened with the excellent opportunities for Measure Y is there was a lot of pent-up demand to do a lot of things, and that is exactly what you did, especially with Vicki, with her leadership and direction. She came in and started working on things. A lot of those things were reactive. Things were hurting. Your network was not in great shape. It was in poor shape. That was one of the first things that was attacked to bring that up to snuff. And that was really a reactive mode. Many things in IT are reactive, but everything should not be reactive. There needs to be a proper balance between reactive and proactive. And the intent and the activities under goal one talk about that shift and design a way to do that shift. The next is building a collaborative technology framework. One of the pities in most libraries is, in my opinion, sometimes a shelver has much more knowledge about what patrons like and what they do and what they need than our administrators do, because for a lot of reasons, they're the first people to see things in our libraries, see needs, and they also sometimes have more time to think about it than those of us that are in different sorts of admin positions. So that is a missed opportunity. And so this collaboration framework is nothing new. It's nothing revolutionary. It's something that, though, has not really been articulated very well in any organizations. I've started articulating that and applying it when it's appropriate, and it's certainly appropriate here. And this is showing how the collaboration happens between all levels of staff when it comes to technology. I'm going to come back to that in a minute to give that some more flavor and some more explanation. And then, of course, goal number three is deploying future forward services. You have so many opportunities to do some very dynamic things with the library website and services that would be digital services direct to patrons. Incredibly powerful. Your association with Scenic is unlike anything. That's the Scenic data network, the way that you're connected, that all libraries, the vision is to have them all connected on this high-speed backbone. There are yet unexplored opportunities with that Scenic connection, and I'm just thrilled because I think you can do something with that. Now, you might say, Carson, we have a question. One of the things that you were going to dig into here, and especially with the help of Melissa Stockton, our ILS expert, is a replacement of the ILS, because we have some issues with the ILS that have been reported. And as we started doing our discovery, both Melissa and I started thinking, I think there's a bigger problem here than just the ILS. Now, I'm not saying that there's not issues with the ILS. In fact, we collected a lot of documentation, and that's a big part of the support documents that we'll have moving forward to get started on tackling the ILS problems. But I want to illustrate for the commission and for library staff, this is also something that this presentation here that I'm going to give you, I also gave it to many different staff groups to see if there are any holes in our thinking. And we received nothing but enthusiastic feedback for this way of presenting things. Now, when you have an integrated library system, the online card catalog, your view of it, including whether you like it or whether you don't like it, has to do with your relationship to it, right? So if you're a patron, you have one sort of relationship. If you're a staff member, you might have a relationship that looks like one of these little boxes here. So you might be part of the circulation system and deal with the holdings and the physical materials and the patron database. You might be part of the acquisitions process for the library. So a library the size of Sonoma, acquisitions, very important to be able to automate in the best way possible, purchasing and getting materials that you own on the shelves. There's also a web interface there. And so when people were talking about the ILS, they were talking mainly about these functions. But wait, there's more. So we've got things that are also related to the ILS that the ILS helps us deliver to patrons, but they're not things that we own, and they all have a little bit different rules, and it's a part of what we're doing now in libraries. We're connecting people to subscription databases. Horrible name. We still haven't come up with a great name for that, but they are essential, and I'm going to call them subscription databases right now. We have ebooks. We have audio and video sorts of offerings. And now these are things, though, they're not really part of our holdings. We lease these things. We're renting them, basically, on behalf of our patrons. And so that provides a different challenge. And some of these challenges, of course, came up in some of the issues that were not performing as well in the ILS. And then we have something very important, and that's unique local content. And you can see by the way that it's drawn here, we have a local history digital archive, and that's something that needs some attention that we called out for in the plan. They also, that department is doing excellent work. They also have an archive management system, which doesn't really connect that well. We wish it could. But there might be a way to do that as part of design, which I'll get to in a minute. But right now, that we also see a different web interface that's connected to that local history digital archive. So if you're thinking, wait a minute, is this starting to get a little confusing? We've got two web interfaces for materials that the library can connect me to. The answer is yes, that is getting there. And right now we have kind of a dotted line connector between the local history archive and the ILS. I've usually been making cataloging records in the ILS so that some of the stuff on the local history archive can be discovered and found. That doesn't always work that great. But wait, there's even more. There's what we can call the library's website. And this is where it starts getting even messier in terms of the enormity of what we need to do, what we need to tackle when we're talking about improving our services to patrons in this digital realm and, frankly, our services to staff as a digital tool. The library website gives us yet a third interface that we try to put all together. Now, there's other stuff that gets piled onto this, and we try to stick it wherever we can. This is the natural building of different web presences. Every library does it a little bit differently based on the skills of the folks putting it together, based on the materials that they have, et cetera. And there's some dotted line relationships between some of the stuff, but it starts getting pretty kludgy pretty quick, and it's not awesome. So one of the ways that we attack that is to have a slightly better system, not a broadly better system, a slightly better system called a discovery interface. And the idea behind the discovery interface is it's kind of the go-between all these different sources of information that we want to gather together to provide to patrons and to staff. And so in doing the investigation of what to do with the ILS, a couple things had come up, and we created a chart of this as well that we shared with library staff. We took all of the issues that had arisen, and Melissa did some research to see if perhaps there were some features of the current ILS that were not being as utilized as well as they could be. And that was the case in some cases. In some cases, it doesn't perform as people would like, and that's how most ILSs are. But the reason, though, that we're recommending this direction and not going in and saying do a rip and replace of an ILS is because that's problematic as well. Generally, when you change ILSs, you're changing one set of problems for another set of problems. I don't think that's what anyone wants to do. What we want to do is have better services based on criteria. The other thing that we discovered in the process of going through this is that the library right now, because of that reactive mode, does not even really have a venue to gather stakeholders together who are affected to say, what is it that we need? And when you see all these circles on here, especially at the bottom where we've got the ILS, we've got the library website, we've got the local history digital archive, those are different systems that have to have different criteria as well. I think the local history effort, for instance, could benefit from a more modern system. You may end up replacing the ILS, but the first thing to do is to say, what is our, where are issues, what is our criteria, and what is our criteria for having these things all play together? So the first step is gathering stakeholders together to explore and to create that criteria and then test it against different solutions that might exist. So that'll be, that process, suggesting that process is in the plan. It'll also be part of a technical document to allow the library to get a kickstart in that process of gathering the right stakeholders around this very big issue. This is something that will take a little while to completely unravel and to correct. But this is the idea of a strategic technology plan, because you want to fix these big problems, not look at them in a granular sense, but look at the whole thing and to say, how can we move forward? Another important part of the plan that I wanted to talk about is this collaborative technology framework, just to give it some identification. Especially in a big library, we can look at our silos that we have, and silos exist in all organizations of all types. And sometimes it looks like they're working as happy and orderly until they fail, until they start breaking apart and dumping that smelly silage everywhere. Nobody likes that. The solution, though, is again, it's something that I've observed in healthy organizations my entire life. It's rarely articulated in this manner or articulated at all, because usually it just comes from an awesome leader, an excellent leader who comes in, understands how to set a tone that I'm going to describe, and does the maintenance to follow through on setting that tone and reinforcing the positive behaviors of collaboration. That's a good thing for a strong leader. It's just not fair for the world to just have that in the purview of a strong leadership. I think that this can be done in a cookbook style. It does take time to work through, but this collaboration in terms of technology is key. It's just not okay in this day and age for anyone working in a library to not feel comfortable with technology tools. Technology is how we are delivering our services to patrons, even when they're not technology-based. It's our back-end systems that give us that ability to do that. So the idea is to take things that happen now, because there is collaboration going on at Sonoma Libraries. In fact, I was able to witness the Hotspot Committee, and that's one of the examples that we used as a basis for this collaboration framework, because it was combined the earlier thought of having a venue to bring together stakeholders to identify criteria and to spread out the work, and to do it in a way that's not in an ongoing fashion. It's kind of ad hoc. You just gather for that particular purpose. So this model, the idea is you identify the primary groups and people responsible for technology end-to-end. Articulate where the points of collaboration will happen, because collaboration is the key. It's not a situation where it's like, hey, it's that person's job to do that, and this is my job. This is actually more of a question of how do we work together so that we're all equipped to serve patrons. It also charts the path for collaboration and staff development. And the idea is that it plays to existing strengths, and it increases general library staff mastery and comfort with technology. In all of the stakeholder engagements in the surveys, a common theme that came up for Sonoma Libraries is that folks wanted people working in the library overall, in a general sense, to have greater comfort and mastery of their technology tools. And so this is one way to get there. This is a description, our graphic showing what collaboration looks like in many libraries, and this may be accurate right now for Sonoma. We tend to think of patrons being over to the side, mostly interacting with library staff, and then there's some sort of IT structure in the organization to provide support. That little gray circle there, that is kind of the organic collaboration that happens. That happens when you have awesome people in the same environment. They find ways to work together and to learn and to do things, but it's not done in any formal way. And what's bad about that is when you don't do it in a formal way, people don't know what's expected of them. They also don't know what they need to learn or what they should learn to do really good in their jobs. And so the idea of the collaboration framework is we think about it as we do have jobs that are specific to IT and jobs that are specific to library staff, thinking that we're all library staff for a moment. But our biggest place that we want to work is on that collaboration. Now, there's some things on that in that collaboration, thinking of it as a continuum, that are more heavily weighted on IT. Enterprise services such as the data network, doing backups, attending to the structures that keep our websites up and running, doing tech support at certain levels and building, yes. On the library staff side, guess who sees that patron who comes in with that mobile device and says, here, look what I just got for a present. How does this work? So there's more responsibility on the library staff to be able to respond to patrons in that area. And there's a huge interaction. That mobile device uses an enterprise resource, the Wi-Fi network in most cases, to operate. And so it's very important that there's a collaboration so that even if a library staff member was helping troubleshoot or teach a patron how to use it, that they also had some knowledge of how the Wi-Fi system works and not that many don't, but I mean in general, how the Wi-Fi system works and how they can, at what level they go to on their own to try to correct any issues that they're discovering, like just a drop out of the signal or something like that. So I won't talk any more about that, but I want you to notice that big green circle in the middle. And that's to remind us that we all have patrons first. And sometimes in the IT department, we don't think of that. But if you go back to this graphic right here, that shows the IT department as being responsible for at least facilitating many direct patron services. So I think it's very important for that cross that cross-discipline approach to that. Now, I'm going to stop there because this plan has a lot of things in it. I'm sure that you have some questions. We just had so much to explore there. I wanted to kind of stick to what I thought would be the biggest things or the things that you'd want me to dive into. But I would love to hear any questions or comments.
Okay. David?
Yeah, Carson. I'm looking at the integrated library system and the discovery layer. And from what you said, you can't just patch or fix part of the ILS because you have unforeseen difficulties and side effects. Is it fair to say that the discovery layer is sort of a giant patch on the ILS? And if so, will we ever move to a new ILS, or is it even efficient to do so?
You're touching on my favorite topic. I promise not to talk about it very long, but you're very astute in calling it a patch, because that's exactly what it is. The problem that we have with ILSs is they were all designed a very long time ago, and we're using what's called legacy technology. I'm very happy that we have vendors that are serving our market and are helping us with technology. However, the very data structures of ILS are long in the tooth. They are not modern, web-aware, web-enabled data structures, and that's where most of our frustrations come from, in that interaction that we have in the patch. And so one of our discoveries in looking at this is if we concentrate on something that's better, not groundbreakingly better, but it is better, the discovery layer, the discovery interface. Polaris iOS, the Circe ILS actually has a lot more access to the data components. Even though the data structures are older, there's a lot more access on that system. So that makes us say, we don't want to change that really quick. We don't want to just turn that off if that would give us the best chance of success based on criteria for discovery to work really well.
Stephen.
Well, no, but it helps a little bit.
He feels that it didn't answer his question fully.
I just want to know Carson, one of my questions is, can we ever get unstuck from our present ILS?
Yes. The way to get unstuck, and thank you for restating the question. I went too far in the weeds there. The way to get unstuck again is to understand what it is that we need, what we need at Sonoma Libraries to serve our patrons better, and to squeeze out the best performance of our systems now that we have at any of those layers in the chart to make them as best as we can, and put pressure on our vendors to say, this is still not good enough. And that's what a system like Sonoma can do. They can talk to the vendors and to say, you know, this is not performing in the way that we want. And also, I do want to say, and I'm not precluding the possibility that Sonoma will get a different ILS, that maybe, you know, after building the criteria and testing it against the other needs, that might be what happens. So if that's what you mean by getting unstuck, as well, I think that's a possibility.
Okay, Stephen, now.
Following up on that theme about getting unstuck, I'm familiar with strategic plans that actually have timelines and deliverables. So let's follow up on getting unstuck from our ILS situation. You mentioned that we need to determine our criteria. You mentioned that you need to have convening of stakeholders and determining who they are. Again, I'm familiar with approving strategic plans that address these particular issues, have a timeline and dates associated, and deliverables. So can you address that?
Absolutely. Starting on page 46 of the big plan, That is where the time frames and the tasks under each of the goals is placed. And so just as an example, looking at shifting from shifting from reactive to proactive between 2019 and 2020. Building the collaborative framework, since those are interactive goals and probably go into 2021, and then starting to build future forward services 2021 to 2022 in a 3-year plan. And I'll be very brief as far as the actions that are there. We can go into more depth if you like. But under goal one actions, a simple one is completing all open IT projects. The second one is doing immediate improvements to the digital and online services, and that includes optimizing current installation of Circe Dynex. And that is implementing things that have not been implemented yet, or that could be improved through configuration. The other is getting the stakeholder process launched so that we can tackle the bigger problem, get that rolling right away. And then from there, considering changes based to systems based on the criteria that's built. So that's all included there, and that leads to the improvement of the discovery or the criteria. Discovery layer. The other is phase one of two of improving the patron user experience, which is making immediate improvements to the physical experiences in the branches, which includes continuous improvements to self-service technologies, improvements to Wi-Fi printing that's come up, that's everywhere. Everyone has trouble with Wi-Fi printing. I need to put that to the front because it's such a basic. Evaluating and optimizing all patron touch points with technology as well, stepping back and saying what is really working well and what has not worked well and how can we improve that for that. The other is improving data access for managers because the library does collect in a confidential and private way data about different usage through Orange Voice Savannah, which is a product from another vendor that you have, and also there's an installation of people counters to give you a sense of traffic at all that. So it's time to look at all that data in a full sense. The other thing we've done is improving the library's data center that's at the downtown library. It's not it's in bad shape. So either improve that or look at options for locating equipment in a very challenged technology area. Also expanding the library's maker activities, optimizing efficiencies of centralized. Whoops, sorry about that. I think I just lost my microphone. Just keep optimizing the efficiencies of the centralized services. That's something that Vicky's crew does quite a bit of work on. And more than anything, participate strongly in the library's strategic planning process, being ready to equip and to be ready to respond to things that come up there, because that's one thing that we weren't able to address is without a fresh strategic plan, we don't know what our technology response might be. So there's a little room left in this moving from reactive to proactive to participate in that process. The actions under Goal 2 that start on page 49 have a just a light view of the technical document, and this is basically building increased competencies around finding out who should be involved and using project management models to move forward on things and to do them in an ad hoc sort of way. I'm also suggesting that there's more learning and mentoring opportunities that start happening as different areas of collaboration are identified that we're supporting staff and their needs. Identify all staff roles that need to be done, and also make sure that we're respecting the union framework for employees for their jobs and the expectations of them. The future forward services, again, going from 2021 to 2022, this is where we envision building the next generation digital online services. It's taking that that last image of that discovery layer, doing it right. So every one of those connectors, every one of those digital systems that's connected via discovery layer is actually really good. It's really what you want. And that discovery layer is doing a good job of managing the traffic between those systems for the benefit of patrons and for staff. Also, phase two of increasing of the patron user experience, I think in the process of all of the upgrades and refinements to the digital services, there'll be a lot of opportunities to apply those to physical world, yet unseen. Those are potential, but I think that's what will come. Looking at the back end, right now your data infrastructure is good, and I think it needs to stay good by actively managing that. And of course, the connection to Scenic, I think, is extremely exciting, unique to California, and the idea of libraries being able to be connected as research institutions, universities have been able to be connected, but direct patron services is one of the possible benefits. There are a lot of great possibilities with that connection.
Stephen?
Just as a follow-up, and thanks for that response, but these are awfully broad timelines for the implementation of each of these goals, so I'm really hoping that we get periodic updates on where we're at. To have a goal extend for 2 years and then one for three and one for two, would like some more clear guidelines. Thanks.
Yes, and I should say, too, that you're absolutely right. We did, on purpose, stay to the strategic side of this. Also because the IT department has demonstrated high competencies in project management. The last section of the, and I know it's a big document, I apologize, but the last section has given guidelines for the reporting of progress of the goals to you as a commission. So that has been part of that, and I expect that will happen.
Okay, anybody else? Barbara?
Thank you. I have to say that in the terms of technology, I've found it very difficult to hear and understand everything in this presentation via technology. And I hope that the next time you come and visit us, you'll talk to us in person. It just seemed kind of garbled and quick, and I know I missed a lot. In your written report, which I appreciated, I was stunned by this remark about the IOLS. Last year we had a budget surplus, and if memory serves, we put aside a big chunk of money to buy a new ILS. And this finding is that, in looking at the ILS market, current ILS core technology is antiquated, and I believe you were talking about this earlier, making a cross-grade expensive option that may not address the core issues. So it doesn't sound like anybody's got a good ILS new thing to migrate to. So anyway, that's something the commission needs to think about, since we did put aside a big chunk of money for that out of our surplus. I also completely agree with your idea about your focus on collaboration. I think it's very important. And I couldn't tell if you were saying this or not, but I hope there's a place for the commission to be part of the collaboration. I know we have some very skilled and knowledgeable people here on our commission. And I'm not sure what place is, yeah. And then just lastly, a key finding you say is that in assessing the ILS situation, that the library does not yet have a process or a venue to comprehensively gather all the stakeholders to understand the needs, desires, strengths, and shortfalls. And I couldn't hear what you were saying to Stephen, or I didn't understand what you were saying to Stephen, if you have that process designed for us yet.
Yes. With a strategic plan of this size, and you probably experience this with other strategic plans, sometimes things are so detailed, plus the thing that I gave you, that it's helpful for the library to have a framework to operationalize that. And so that is a technical document that I'll be providing. I think we agreed to get that done by the end of this month, to be able to have the guidelines to kickstart that process, to have some instructions and have a little bit of a cookbook to get started.
Okay.
Thank you.
Tom?
Mike, Vicki, this is a question for Vicki. I'd like you to answer this. What happens next? I'm getting the impression this is not a final document that we're going to be asked to approve, that there's going to be more that we're going to have before we actually have a technology plan to approve. Is that correct?
Well, I think I can answer it. I'm hoping that you understand that there is a difference between a strategic plan and a tactical plan. So what we're asking for tonight is for you to look at this overarching strategic plan, and then out of the strategic plan comes deliverables, comes step by step, bullet point by bullet point, about what we will do with what and when. And we, our introduction tonight of a web programmer developer is a key missing link in our skill set, and now we have that in our skill set. And this will be part of the overall tactical plan, because all of this, if you heard Carson speaking, he was talking about the fact that all of these interconnected pieces, an antiquated ILS, and whether it's the one we have or one of the other nameless brand ones, they were all developed around the same kinds of technologies. And so that web interface is the big connector. And so we've got to develop that.
You're going on about all this technology stuff, and what I'm asking is a very specific thing. I think what you're saying is this is a starting point. Mr. Block is going to not be involved in this additional phases of this, and it will be the Sonoma County Library staff that will carry forward. Is that correct?
Well, kind of. I think that one of the things that we are going to be doing with the tactical piece of this will be relying on recommendations that he's made at a higher level, and then we'll take them down to a more specific level. And so what he's going to be doing after this is helping us define those specific bullet points and timelines and how we will pull the people together to carry that out.
Okay, so Mr. Block will be involved in not just the strategic plan, but the more specific plan that's coming forward over the next 2 or 3 years, or
I think all of these things will play out pretty regularly over the next year and the next 2 years. And then as we get to that third year, we'll have to be looking again at what the next steps are, because as you know, the technologies continuously change, and so and that's why a technology strategic plan, 3 years is a push. It's a lot of time for technology.
My last question is, Mr. Block, does his contract that he's under right now include this additional time over the next 2 years, or is that additional money we're going to have to come up with?
Well, right now, what he's produced here and what he's going to give us some guideposts will come out of this existing contract. If we choose to drill down deeper with him, then yeah, we'll have to recontract with him.
Thank you.
David?
Yeah, I have two questions. First to Vicki or Barbara or both. Roughly how much was set aside out of the surplus for the purchase of a new ILS?
Tens of millions.
I think that we set aside an initial $1 million.
Okay.
And these things typically, and seriously, I have migrated many systems, and you know the going price just for discovery layers is $150,000 annually, and to change the whole ILS, probably somewhere in the neighborhood of $2 million or greater.
Okay. Second question is, what's before us this evening? We've not been asked to, I don't think, approve this plan. Is this a staff document that's coming to us for our information?
Let me answer that one. Yes, it is. It's in the consent calendar to be approved. This is the major overview strategic plan, not the weeds, not the specifics of how it's going to be done or what timeline it's going to be done in. It's much more general. And this has been my experience with doing a good strategic plan, is you get the overview and what you want to accomplish. Then you go down to the next layers down. And so we're still at that very top layer of what we want to accomplish and a time frame we want to accomplish in it, not month by month or even, well, possibly year by year, but just a very general time frame, and then we'll begin drilling down.
Right, and if you look at typical things, and I'll just use our infrastructure as an example, switches, routers, Wi-Fi access points. The typical time frame for that, and he's pointed these things out in the strategic plan, is a five-year program. You know, at the end of 5 years, those things are outmoded, outdated, and our infrastructure that we've put in since I've been here was almost 20 years old. So what he's trying to do is give us some guideposts, and then seriously, is give us some guideposts, and then we will build out all of the different pieces of this plan based on, you know, worksheets that are developed with us and for us.
Jason?
Yeah. So in ILS, you know, it's never going to be complete. I think that's a misnomer that, you know, everybody has is, It's not C++, it's not going to be HTML. There's always new technologies, and therefore they're always being integrated. So it's not going to be a complete ILS, one solid deliverable. It'll be a platform and, you know, message or a concept of how to build the ILS. Yeah, I don't know if it's a complete platform. You know,
well, it's built on some very solid database. Platform.
WordPress, or are we talking?
Well, no. So we're talking Microsoft SQL as the database, which is very standard.
Yeah.
But that's the basement layer, and then we have all these other pieces and the connectors. They're programming. They're called API connectors. Not that you care about that, but. All of these things play into taking these Legos and making them fit together.
So I guess my comments would be four. I'd like to see addressed. I'm sure you could take a title and it could be grouped under one of these titles. But I'd like to do an emphasis on line staff training for the new technologies. Make education program. I'm not certain that all staff are up to date on all the new technologies that are coming out. I'd like to see that addressed. And a little more detail, I know it was addressed that, you know, but they're going to be the point people at the library service stations. That's one thing. That gets into another. How about if in the process of this IP is developed with, do we have a policy if IP is developed within the library or among its staff? If we came up with our own system, our own type of intellectual property, do we have a policy or procedure on how to deal with that?
I'm not understanding what you're asking, Jason.
Up with our own.
You mean if we built our own ILS from the ground up?
No.
Used open source?
That's the whole point of Oracle. My question is, if we were to develop some way of integrating it, or our staff develop their own in the process.
Well, I think it's an interactive process. I think, you know, we're very active in the. In the ILS user group, and in fact, our own Mike Daw is the enhancements chair for this. So he works in collaboration with other libraries that are running this system, and helps other libraries push the vendor to create, new workings for us.
But it's not open source, or
no, it is not.
Okay.
It's very standard API connections, programming, and so forth. I think this is. I don't mean to cut you off, but we're not developing this ourselves. You know, this is an off-the-shelf product, and there are existing products that we're not using that we need to expand out into. Like the staff side client, there is a new whole client for that. It's web-based. And we're just, one of the things he's pointing out is that we're not doing all we can with the existing system. And again, this is going to be an iterative process, and I want to just circle back one more time to the fact that this is a overarching strategic model and not a tactical plan. The tactical plan will come out. We will sift that out together and come up with that.
Okay, one more thing that I want to address is how do we, I guess I'm not certain of the intention of the strategic plan. For example, are we addressing the public interface? So, you know, for example, I talked with a lot of senior citizens who feel they're nowhere near this level of understanding. There's still the smartphone, flip phone. So are we also addressing how to catch people up to that are library users? I mean, I don't know. I guess what are we trying to do with this plan?
I do think what we're trying to do with this plan is to have a bit of an overarching future vision. And there are lots of pieces to this. And that's why it's important to look at it from a strategy standpoint versus a tactical plan.
Stephen?
Well, then, yes, I would like an answer to, are we already contracted with this entity to provide us a technical plan? You said that we've already contracted with them to provide guideposts, but is that any different than a technical plan? What the ultimate question is, how much more money are we committing ourselves to beyond what we've already approved for what's before us tonight?
Right, and what I'm saying to you, Stephen, is that we have agreed that this presentation is it, along with some tactical documents that are going to be delivered to us that I expect we'll have by the end of the month. I don't have a plan to continue to work more and more with this consultant. I think some of the things that we've learned and some of the guideposts, and you can jump in here anytime, Carson.
Yeah, the intent is that this is a package. This is a package for you to take and to take the ball and run, because there's so many things happening right now. And the idea is to bring some order or some direction with there'll be more demands next month and the month after that, et cetera. So, yes, my understanding is this is, with the exception of the guidepost document that you've been going through, This is the work that provided for this contract.
You're pretty muffled. Can you repeat what you just said? Because I don't think anybody got it.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Is that better? Can you hear me better?
Yes.
Okay, I'm a little bit closer to my microphone. I'll look a little awkward in here. No, my understanding is that this is I've fulfilled the scope of work that you hired me to do. We decided that I would provide, at no additional cost, of course, those technical documents to help kickstart some of these processes. The guidepost documents is how Vicki referred to them. Yeah, there's no additional work. This is my work.
Okay.
Did that answer your questions?
Tom?
Vicki, I have one question for you. Do you feel comfortable with this plan that we have in front of us tonight as a strategic plan from which you can go forward and get the specifics?
I do, and I wouldn't have brought it here to you if I didn't. I feel that it's touching on the vision that we have to have for this organization, and it had to be initially very high level, and it gives us a place to start. And we've already done some of the important stuff, and now we need to drill down to how do we make sure our staff has the training that they have have to have when someone walks in with an iPad and says, my kids gave me this for Christmas, how do I make this thing work? And we already have a lot of that going on. How do we expand upon those kinds of things? That will be the work of both IT, public services staff, and everyone else in the organization. I hope that answers you. Does anybody else have any other questions for me?
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Vicki. And thank you, Carson, very much.
Thank you so much for the interest.
Complicated information, but I think we may have it now. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I'll hope you all have a good night.
You too. Bye. Okay. Okay, let's do public appearances. Is there any public here that wants to make any comments, or do they have anything to say? Okay, no. Okay, now I have a question for the commission. We have some people sitting here from Sebastopol, and I know they've been here for a while, and we have a closed session, which we know may take a while. So could we bump let the lab forward to now?
Yes.
And
yes.
Then...
Yes.
Continue our meeting. All righty. Is that everybody agree with that?
Yes.
Oh, 2 seconds at least. Okay. Okay, Sebastopol Lab, would you like to make your presentation now?
We've scheduled about 10 minutes.
I know.
then questions.
And I'm giving a smart answer.
Okay. Close to the microphone. Okay. Thank you. Well, as you may have surmised, I'm Walt Fraser. I'm the vice chair of the Sebastopol Library Advisory Board and also a member of the Friends of the Sebastopol Library. Oh, sorry. Really close. Oh, push that again. Sorry, I'm kind of technologically backwards. As you'll find out, 60 years ago when I was a kid, libraries were repositories of books overseen by stern women who seemed to shush a lot. If you lived in a big city, there were a lot of books. Otherwise, you made do with what was on the shelves. As time has gone by, our society's changed a lot, and libraries have changed too. The books are still there, but there are many other resources available in print, but also on computers. And with the internet access in libraries, vast amounts of information are instantly available in even the smallest branch libraries. Another important change beyond the reading habits of people is the fragmentation of our society. Ironically, with the coming of the information age and social networking, humans have become increasingly isolated from one another. Meanwhile, libraries have morphed into community centers with storytime events for kids, places to hang with friends and do homework for teens, places to study things like history, stocks, and genealogy for adults, as well as lectures by authors and performances by magicians and musicians. The best libraries, like Sebastopol's, reach out even further, connecting with local businesses, schools, and marginalized groups within the larger community, like the deaf and non-English speakers. The amazing thing for me about the Sebastopol branch manager and staff are the variety of offerings for the entire community. With their imagination and know-how, this library has become the central gathering place for a diverse community. One program this summer is called Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Scarves. Librarian Courtney Klein says it grew out of a craft program at all 12 library branches last year to make Harry Potter wands using yarn as an adornment. She found that there was extra yarn left over that just happened to be in the color of the 4 Hogwarts houses. So why not learn to knit house scarves while listening to Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone? Courtney says she was expecting somewhere between 5 and 10 kids. Imagine my surprise, she says, when about 30 people showed up for their first program. With the help of Sevastopol friends, as well as system funds, Courtney was able to purchase knitting needles locally. Starting in early June, she found that there were new people as well as those returning to finish their scarves and listen to the book. Senior volunteers as well as teens with knitting experience come every week. Let me digress for a minute here and point out how important volunteers are for making the Sevastopol Library the gem it is. Our volunteers log between 300 and 400 hours per month, and there is a waiting list for this kind of community participation. Another summer program involved taking the library to the park. Librarian Audrielle Ahern came up with the idea of mixing reading and group playtime to reach those who weren't aware of what they were missing at the library. Willard Libby Park hosts family story time for 2 to 8-year-olds and their parents, alternating with games with a 12-foot rainbow parachute. That makes kids laugh, makes everyone laugh, says Audrielle. Kids from baby age to 12-year-olds come regularly, and we've had people who haven't been to the library before story time in the park who do come after taking part in the activity. At the library, you would expect to have book clubs, and Sevastopol has three, one of which is the Social Justice Book Club. Now in its second year, Audrielle said the group was started because we thought the community needed a place to discuss social issues in a safe and respectful way. Inspired by the Sonoma County Library's Together at the Table program series, the Social Justice Book Club focuses on a single book each month, and the Friends of the Library provides those interested with free copies. Library staff take turns in hosting the event. We get to choose the books and issues we feel passionate about, says Audrielle. All staff are included, from the branch manager to library associates and aides, as long as they're really passionate about it and want to do it, and that makes it unique. While there are times people disagree, the hosts work to make sure that the discussion is orderly and respectful. Recent titles have included the books The New Jim Crow for Black History Month, Yes Means Yes for Sexual Assault Awareness Month, and Queer There and Everywhere for LGBTQ Month. Another example of library outreach is the Annalee High Book Club, where 15 to 18 students spend their lunch hour discussing a book they select with librarian Rosalie Abbott, with books and pizza provided by the Friends of the Library. And let me add here that Rosalie was recognized last month by the California Library Association, which awarded her the Young Adult Services Award for 2019. A program called Signing Saturdays provides an opportunity for West County community members to meet up, practice, and learn to communicate using sign language. Open to deaf, hard of hearing, and hearing people of all skill levels, attendees have included community members from 10 months to 90 years old. Rosalie said she is excited that a deaf baby and children who are hard of hearing are all able to gain something. One woman who grew up with deaf parents told Rosalie that in the 60 years she has lived in the West County, there has never been a program to support those using or wishing to practice American Sign Languages until now. 2 years ago, with the support of the Sevastopol Friends at the Library, we purchased 6 sewing machines. Since then, the library has been hosting classes and community sewing events called BYOM, Bring Your Own Machine. Rosalie says patrons can bring their own sewing machines and learn about them, or use one of the library's. As with other library programs, volunteers help patrons work on their own projects, or they will provide simple ones that anyone can find satisfaction doing. This is an intergenerational program where people of all ages can come together to sew, create, or repurpose clothing. Rosalie says sometimes the meeting room will break out in applause when one of the patrons finishes their project. The Girls Who Code program provides girls the opportunity to learn about computer science and help close the gender gap in the tech industry. expert IS volunteers encourage girls to explore and learn to write computer programs, including creating apps, websites, chatbots, and even computer games like Pizza Eating Zombies. Rosalie says this library offering is based on the work of a nonprofit organization with the same name, Girls Who Code, working to close the gender gap in technology and change the image of what a programmer looks like and does, and to encourage girls to explore new career opportunities. Drop-in Tech Help offers an opportunity for older community members to get one-on-one help with any kind of technology they can imagine. Patrons who use this service often feel like they've been left behind as the IS world moves ahead, and they just need someone to help them catch up. Once again, volunteers provide the know-how, and the library provides the venue. To mitigate the fact that our library is at capacity, the Sebastopol Library is so busy with students sitting on floors at times it is difficult to access the shelves and books, the staff has worked to create additional outdoor seating where teens and others can study, work, and hang out. We selected locally made benches created by teens participating in the Sonoma County probation camp. With a grant from the Gravenstein Health Action Chapter to purchase the benches, the City of Sebastopol helped prepare the site, and the Sebastopol Rotary Club did all the heavy lifting. Two other examples of the library using innovation outside its walls are the Student Art Banner Project and the Weather Station. The Banner Project, organized by local artist Carol Watanabe, takes the work of high school students and transforms them into weatherproof banners that adorn the otherwise boring outside brick walls. Funded by the Friends, the artworks are selected by instructors and blown up into banners by Mrs. Watanabe. Meanwhile, on the roof of the library, a small weather station monitors the temperature, wind, humidity, barometric pressure, and rainfall. The readings are available online through the Weather Underground 24/7 and on a screen inside the library. This was made possible by a generous grant from the Sonoma County Public Library Foundation. There are other programs that there isn't time to cover here, not in 10 minutes, but the main point I want to make is that as a lab member and as a friend of the library, I have found my job is less to steer and advise staff of the Sebastopol Library than it is to support and enable them. It's too easy to criticize people these days, but I've always felt that if somebody is doing a really outstanding job, one is obligated to encourage them, and I'm hoping the commission will feel the same. Thank you for listening.
Okay, thank you, Walt. Are there any comments or questions from the Barbara?
Thank you so much. We got your report in our packet, and mm-hmm. I was just dazzled by the intelligence and the detail and all the involvement that you have personally had, but how beautifully you wrote everything up.
Oh, well, thank you.
And added all these great details and stuff. It was really wonderful. I wanted to ask you a question, since you are a lab member and a friend,
right,
and you're obviously deeply immersed in volunteerism at your library.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any comments about the overlap, perhaps, between the lab and the friends, or whether it gets confusing, or they're both necessary, or I don't know, I'm not trying to lead you, but I also used to be in the lab and a friend, mm-hmm. and they're slightly different functions, but I'm just wondering about your experience there in Sebastopol.
I have to admit, I think in orientation by, you know, staff members and others, there is a little bit of overlap. But they really are different, you know, organizations. The lab is tied to the system, the library system, whereas I think the Friends' main focus is basically is more on the Sebastopol Library and its interests, just not including anything else. Does that answer your question?
Do you feel there's a lot of clarity and there's a need for both groups because they have different functions?
Yeah, I think so. And of course, it depends on the different library. In this particular case, I began as a lab member thinking, okay, I'm supposed to provide advisory, you know, skills. And the more I got into what this particular library does, the more I think, they don't need my advice. You know, I need to learn from them. And again, the deeper I got into it, the more I started to look at these lists of the things that, of course, all the libraries host. But then this particular library, and I've thought, you know, how could you talk about this just for 10 minutes? You have to really condense it a lot. So, as I say, in this case, I understand that with other libraries and at certain times, when there are issues coming up, that having a direct input from the public to the board or the commission is really important.
And how long have you been doing both, roughly?
2.5-3 years.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for all that you're doing. It was very impressive, a report, and really, we all really appreciate all the volunteers and members of both Friends and the lab, so appreciate your coming.
Okay, thank you for listening.
Okay, anybody else? Thank you, Walt, very, very much. And thank you to Sebastopol Lab and Library. Anyway, okay. I guess we're gonna go into closed session now. We will be seeing you all in a while. Hopefully we'll be able to do this quickly. We have one for Rohnert Park, Katati, Petaluma, and a reappointment for Sonoma Valley. So let's start with Rohnert Park, Katati.
I think Jason should do that. He's the one.
Okay, then let's go to Petaluma, and he is here.
I am here.
Okay.
I just
got to
find it.
What is it, six?
Okay.
Please use your microphone.
And we're doing Petaluma.
Okay, thank you. Let's see, I move by resolution that is this right here? Okay, here it is. That Sonoma County Library Commission appoint the following applicant to the term as listed. Violet Wang to a youth position on the Petaluma Library Advisory Board for a term ending on June 30th, 2001. And 21, excuse me. And I just want to say I did interview Violet, and she's going to be a great addition, and she's going to bring other youth to the lab. So I'm looking forward to this.
I second.
Okay, so Paul Heavenridge moved and Randall Neff second. All those in favor of appointing Violet Wang? Good, okay. Go backwards to Rohnert Park, Katati. Jason. 89.
So, to make a motion, I move by resolution that the Sonoma County Library Commission appoint the following applicant to the term as listed. Carol Sherman to position on the Rohnert Park Katati Library Advisory Board for a term ending on June 30th, 2023. I move by resolution that the Sonoma County Library...
Rohnert Park Katati.
So quick ad lib. She's a very eager, very energetic candidate who will add a lot of energy to the lab.
I second the motion.
Okay, so Jason Moved and Tom seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Okay. We're moving on to Sonoma Valley Library Advisory Board. Tom?
I move by resolution that the Sonoma County Library Commission reappoint the following applicant to the term as listed, Ken Brown, to a position on the Sonoma Valley Library Advisory Board for a term ending June 30, 2023.
Second.
Okay, so Tom moved, Stephen Zolman seconded, tying with Paul Heavenridge. Anyway, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Passed unanimously. Done deal. Okay. Moving on to the commission reports. I'll start as chair. I want to thank you for re-electing me as chair. I do appreciate it. I know I didn't complete all the things I wanted to complete, and I hope to finish them off this next year, and I hope to finish some that I didn't even get started this next year and do even more. I want to thank Barbara for supporting me during this last year. I can't even begin to tell you how much I do appreciate it. She asked questions that I didn't even think about, and I hope she continues to ask some of those questions. And I want to welcome Deborah on as vice chair and tell her that I look forward to working with her. We began integrating, kind of crossing over. I was hoping to use July as a transition month, and I think it worked out fairly well. Okay, I registered for the California Library Association 2019 conference, which is being held in Pasadena, October 24th to 26th. It costs $165 if you're a member of the CLA. It costs $40 to become a member of the CLA. And if you're not a member, it costs $300 and some odd. So $40 is worth it. It comes out pretty good in the end. The early bird registration is up until September 1st. I put the link in here if you are interested in going down to Pasadena for this conference. The link is here that you can check out the whole thing on. Okay, now we also are at a place in time where we are appointing the committees, and on each of your things there is a sheet. It's also in the packet. I hope you will leave them with me tonight, designating your first, second, and third choices in the different areas, and so that Deborah and I can get together and weed through the whole thing and make our decisions as to who's going to be doing what this year. And you don't have to stay. If you've been on a committee, you don't have to stay on it. If you want to move, indicate that you want to move, you want to do something different, that's fine with me. I'm game to consider anything. So, I can't think of anything else that is of importance. So, we'll move on. Commissioner reports. Stephen?
Yes, apologies for not having the report. In addition to the normal meetings that I attend and the advisory committee, I did meet, as I alluded to in my prior comments, with our youth lab member for over an hour and a half, and he gave me his ideas for how we could update one prong of our strategic plan by way of developing mentoring for our youth. Not just to go to college, that's fine if they want to, but more for job development skills, so that was helpful. Also, I've developed and just completed the Sonoma County Resiliency Collaborative Training, and I'm hoping that through our advocacy committee, we can explore a potential partnership with them. That's it, thanks.
Okay, Randall.
My report is mostly in the packet. I wanted to do a shout out to facilities and IT for their work to develop the teen space at Windsor that just opened.
Okay, thank you, Randall. Tom?
No report.
Okay, Andy?
No report.
Deborah?
My report's in the packet. However, I would like to say that the last item is the International Public Library Fundraising Conference in Calgary, Canada. It was fabulous, and what was great was that even though there were library staff there, there were also Library Foundation and Library Friends staff who focus on fundraising and advocacy, and so it was a really different conversation. This is the third year of this conference, and it really is starting to take off. They believe that they can do really great things, and they can work together and building an international group of people who are looking at libraries and how to raise small money, large money, medium money is a really sort of a radical thought in the library world sometimes. So it was great. And there were a couple of other of us there as well. So we had a Sonoma presence that was terrific.
All righty, Karen.
My report's in the packet, but I wanted to also give a shout out to the Library Advisory Board. I thought last week's meeting was wonderful. I asked for input on ideas for presenting to City Council, and they came up with some really great things. They were just bubbling over with terrific comments and about what's going on across the libraries. And I also wanted to note that I went to a great fundraising conference, a two-day conference called Attaining the Transformational Gift of a Lifetime. There were 40 development professionals, one university president, and me. And it was great because I've cool. spent 2 days just kind of soaked up in fundraising stuff. And now I want the gift. So there you go.
Okay.
I'm done.
Okay. Let's see, attended the commission meeting on the 1st, and the Petaluma Friends of the Library on the 9th of July, and we had an interesting meeting with the Friends. They're a little nervous about the refresh and wonder if they'll have a place afterwards, so we had a little nervous discussion about that, but I think Joe, our branch manager, assured them that he was devoted to the Friends, and they were a big, big part of the library, and they would always have a place at the Petaluma Library. We moved the lab meeting to August 28th from July because Joe was going to be on vacation, so for that. And I did interview Violet Wang for the Youth Lab membership, who's a very talented young woman and who's going to bring a lot to the lab. And not only that, I think she's going to bring other youth. She's excited of advocating for that. So. We're excited because we need to get younger people on the labs. So I think that's going to happen. So that's my report.
This is Dave. My report is in the packet.
All right. Jason.
My report is in the packet, but I wanted to highlight some pieces of the report. And then primarily I did attend the fundraising conference that was in Calgary, and this library was amazing. What everything I would imagine a central library to be was encapsulated into this and more, this library itself. I wouldn't quite compare it to the Sangrada Familia, but it was amazing. Let me see, a couple of things I wanted to point out is, one, the library itself has a couple stores or cafes within the library that to sell items, you know, to eat, to drink, coffee. I think they made a decision to do non-alcoholic beverage, to stay non-alcoholic, I believe. I don't know the reasoning behind that, pro or against, but it primarily is cafes. And there was one on the exterior of the library and one inside the library itself. I thought that was interesting. Because I always went to libraries and, you know, I was told not to eat or drink when I went inside. So that's new. Also inside is they had a really cool mobile cart, so they had items that were made and produced from Calgary on this cart that represented ideals or parts of Calgary or the library system, and that they could also buy online these same items that were part of the mobile cart. And you had two options of either paying for delivery or they would deliver them as part of the route to the library and you could pick it up there for free. So this has been wildly popular there as well. And then I think what most appealed to me was they had a special, and I listed the number you could call to find out more, but they had a special section dedicated to people with that needed services, additional services such as hearing or sight or other, not disabilities, but lack of, what's the word?
Assistance,
thank you. And you could use it, and they had a special library card that provided these services as well, and you can call a number. For example, you could call the mobile van and it would drop off books to your senior citizen community or something of that nature, but they call it a for special services cardholder section. And one thing that stood out to me was they had large print for nonfiction books for people who had eyesight difficulties. So it was just, I hadn't seen this before in a library, and so I thought this was another engaging and innovative section as part of the library. Oh, and they also had their own little art gallery that had pieces from local artists in Calgary that I thought was pretty neat.
Thank you, Jason. Barbara.
Thank you. I'd refer you to my report on page, take my glasses off here, 96 and 97. Got some more photos on here. I wanted to, I won't go through it all, obviously, but I did want to point out at the top some photos of two of our wonderful staff, Werner Park Library, Tara Emerson and Joe Jennings, and they cooked up this great idea of community conversation. So every Friday at 10 o'clock, you go down to the library conference room. They have sweet rolls and coffee, and you just talk about anything. You can talk about the library services or whatever. And I've gone twice and just had great conversations with incredible people, moms and retirees and all kinds of people. So it's been very interesting, and I commend them for this creative idea. I also, on July 10th, the Moonlighters come to Roanoke Park, and we always have this great outdoor concert every year, and Sally Tomatoes offers free dinner every year, and it's just a long-standing tradition. I think it's wonderful. I hope anybody might come another year. We can dance, and anyway, it's a great time. I did attend the ribbon cutting at the teen area with Randall was there, and we had numerous public officials there, and there's a photo down there in the corner of that ribbon cutting. I thought the staff at the Windsor branch did a marvelous job. It's a really nice looking library now, and kudos to all involved with that, and also the tech people, like Randall said. And then also wanted to point out the photo op that we were all invited to. I was able to go to that with Jason. Jason was there, and David was there. And kudos to Jason for getting Sutter to sign the Pledge of Support. That was great. Created a little competitive spirit here, so I'm trying to get St. Joseph's to sign. And then Saturday was the last distinguished speaker at the summer reading program, Distinguished Speaker Series, and it was in Sonoma. So Jake and I started the morning in Petaluma, and we went to this great presentation on the history of D Street that Catherine Reinhart presented, a huge crowd. And then we dashed over to Sonoma and went to the Distinguished Speaker Series and heard this fantastic author. I didn't know her. She grew up, she's an Iranian, and she grew up in the United States at the time of the Iranian Revolution, as I mentioned. And she, I don't know how she made it funny, but she was just unbelievably excellent. And I did talk to Chris Levanish after, and I said, we need to have this more than the summer reading program, Distinguished Authors, because they've just been top-notch. I've been to two of them. And she agreed that maybe in the conversation moving forward, we can continue that, because they're just wonderful, and big crowds turn out and stuff. So anyway, kudos to everybody. Library's doing a great job. Thank you.
All righty, and report for me. I think the one thing I want to bring to everybody's attention is that the Cloverdale Chamber of Commerce held a mixer in the library. And it was really neat to see, because it was another one of those examples of people mixing, obviously, where electeds could be available. Unfortunately, everybody was either at a conference or on vacation, but the opportunity, and I'm hoping that maybe the commissioners from some of the different cities could encourage their chamber to do something of this nature. They did serve alcohol, they had the permission, and somebody else took care of it, so, but it was good, because they mixed, and again, the amazing part was they heard some of the amazing things that libraries were doing, and they were blown away by it. It was a new set of people, so I think that's great. Okay, moving on, director evaluation, committee to the committee report, starting with director's evaluation. We held a meeting tonight, as you know, and we are going to be, the Director's Evaluation Committee will be meeting within the next 30 to 45 days with Ann, and we will be moving forward. So, finance.
There was no finance committee meeting due to the rush of end of year stuff. The next meeting will be August 19th. But I would like to point out, if you look at the financial documents at the end of the packet, you'll notice we have very big surpluses in both of the funds.
Okay. Advocacy.
The report is in the packet. Thank you.
Okay. The foundation liaison.
I don't know if this is in your purview, but I hope it is. We really need a PowerPoint for commissioners to take and show to their jurisdictions. We've talked about it a long time, and we don't have a standard thing, and we need it fairly soon.
No, thank you.
You know, with the budget just decided and so forth, I think it'd be a great time to have one. Thank you.
Okay. So now the foundation liaison, Jason.
Yes, we're just real quick. Most of the meeting was dedicated to talking about staff innovation grants, which are small grants to divvy it up. I think everybody is fairly aware of them. But the grants provided by the foundation that staff members of the library can apply for innovative programs that they want to come out with. Some examples have been so far Blender Bike at the Sebastopol Library, the piano at the Central Library, and this was new to me, where you can go and play the piano and listen to yourself and learn, and you have headphones on, so not everybody else is listening and learning with you. And so there's a ton of programs that have been started with these innovation grants. So it was decided to do two cycles a year, and they are currently undergoing the process of looking at the grants that have that were proposed thus far. Also, we talked about mark it on your calendar. August 22nd is Chocolate and Cinemas, the big fundraiser so far for the year, So that will be then. What we also talked about is the bookmobile that is under guidance from somebody else, and the disengagement from the foundation, which is still occurring. He is now finding vehicle insurance, work comp, providing all the structure necessary to separate himself from the foundation. So that is still on track to be finished and separated. Also instituting his own payroll. So he's completing this process, which should be done hopefully within the next few months before the end of the year. Any other thing reportable? That is about it. I think a lot of the efforts going forth in the near term are towards Chocolate and Cinemas.
All righty. And Measure Y Oversight Liaison, Randall.
The next meeting of the Measure Y Oversight Committee is this Wednesday at 2:00 in the Central Library Boardroom. And we'll start, they'll be working on their annual report.
Okay. SOP Committee, Karen? Oh, no, excuse me. Wait a minute, Roseland Coalition. Stephen.
Yes, lots of good ongoing discussions, and the community from everybody that I spoke to is super excited and definitely looking forward to the date when we can like open up the full space, the full new temporary space. Lots of discussions about how and recommendations for programming to take place at that new facility. Ongoing discussions with folks at SSU. I mentioned the Sonoma County Resiliency Collaborative, and lots of other people have expressed interest about how to fill the space with lots of cool energy and lots of relevant, culturally relevant programming for that community. And then also lots of ongoing discussions about how to do the capital fundraising for the long-term space that we hope to, and we feel confident we'll get into. And again, props to Jason for getting Sutter. That was a huge boon. And thanks for confirming tonight, because I thought Kaiser was on board already. So between Kaiser and Sutter and Barbara, you mentioned maybe, yeah, working on that. That is huge, because that's going to provide the leverage that we need to have people start opening their pockets in addition to just, you know, signing the pledge. So cheers.
All righty. Now, Karen, SOP Committee.
Reports in the packet.
All righty. Foundation Committee hasn't met. Commission thing hasn't met. Okay, the bylaws. Tom.
We hope next month to have a report with draft bylaws for you to look at, not to vote on, just because it's real complex.
Thank you. Commission Orientation Committee, that hasn't met, and the All-Day Lab Committee. We are in the process at this point in time of deciding on a date in the early fall for the next meeting, at which we hope to accomplish some things that were not accomplished in the first All-Day Lab. In other words, defining some action items and some specific areas that labs can support the commission and support the library. So, okay. Question?
Thank you for that report. And yes, please do everything you can to have that next date before all of our youth go back to school, because my youth commissioner would really love to attend, but it needs to be before they all go back to school. So I'm making a huge plug for the next sit down to be before schools come back into session. Thank you.
Don't they go back in session like in this next week or so?
Some of them.
Well, hopefully on a break. That's we can attract the most lab, most youth leaders. Timing it with a school break, I don't know. But I would love to see their participation.
Okay. Will do. Okay, we're down to the consent calendar. There are four items on the consent calendar. Is there anyone that anybody would like to pull or has a question about? Okay, so then
I move adoption of the consent calendar.
I second.
Okay, so McKenzie moved, and I heard Cahill's voice first. Mm-hmm. So to do the consent calendar, all those in favor, say aye.
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 All those opposed? Passed unanimously. Okay, we are now down to action items by motion. Do I hear a motion for the approval of the monthly packet distribution process? David Cahill moved it. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Jason's second. Okay, all those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. I guess I should ask, was there any discussion? I'm sorry, I'm getting trying to hurry for you guys. So, okay.
Also, any public comment?
Yeah. Okay. Is there any public comment? There's no public. That's what I was looking for earlier. Okay. There is no public. So let's go back to the vote again. All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? Okay. Passed unanimously. Moving on to approve the agreement with Library Solutions. Anne, I'll let you talk.
So we issued an RFP for a consultant to help us with a commission retreat, a OMT retreat, some leadership management or leadership development training for the branch managers, and then facilitating a strategic plan. We received 6 responses to the RFP. I reviewed them all with regard to a chart that I developed looking for certain characteristics like do they have experience with local government, with JPAs, with public libraries, have they done strategic planning before, how are they with organizational development and leadership training. After scoring all of them, then Reese and Deborah and I had follow-up phone conversations with 2 of them, and ultimately we selected Library Solutions, and you can find the information in your packet if you'd like to read more about them.
All right. Any questions? Randall?
I'm very concerned that there's not a line item in here to have a forum meeting at each of the branches, that we need to be inclusive and be equal, that we can't have just a couple of meetings and force people to drive around the county in the evening.
No, I completely agree with you.
I totally second that, because I'm not going to vote in favor of this. I mean, I can, if we direct you to sign the agreement and then with an addendum that we need to reallocate money for them to have these meetings at each of the branch libraries, if we end up there, then I'll vote to approve.
As so I have discussed with the consultant, we will work out all the details of the strategic planning process as we go along, and I feel very strongly that we do need to have meetings in every location, focus groups, community meetings, so that will certainly happen.
Well, my concern is on page 162, it says a maximum of 4 forums,
right?
And then under 162.
But where on 162?
Up here. Forums, maximum 4. And then on Roman numeral IV, it says challenges. The locations are a challenge. And yes, that's a major challenge in the county. But we need to have it spelled out in the contract that there will be a forum at every branch.
Yeah.
I agree, and we can make that change.
Karen?
I just had a question. Do we have, is there any description of the scope of the commission retreat?
Not as yet.
Okay. I guess my concern there is, I know there's been a lot of conversation about there needing to be commissioner training and so forth. I think this is probably different than training, but I'm not really sure what it is.
Oh, you're looking at me. Sorry.
Barbara had her hand up.
Okay, Barbara.
Yeah, I had the same concern as Karen. I don't know what this is. I thought it was a lot of money for one day, $3,200, and I don't know what she's going to cover. We have this, I have already talked about having somebody really kind of specialize in JPA and, you know, all that kind of stuff. I just felt that this was a lot of money to all get together with anyone on any details on, you know, what we're asking to do. I know the kind of concept is you want the same person to be big picture with everybody, the staff, the commission, and everybody, and that makes a lot of sense. But I feel like this is a little too vague, and I certainly second the thing about every library. When we did the last strategic plan, it was kind of, you know, I planned up every other branch, and it was just like people didn't go. You know, they weren't driving around to go. It was not comprehensive. So I think these details need to be spelled out before we should adopt this, unless you have a time frame issue. Or
would it be possible to, or would you consider accepting the contract with the change in going to every branch for information? Paul?
So Anne, as I read this, it seemed like this was where we were going to hire this individual for strategic planning, not for board training. Is that did I read that correct?
It's all part of the same package. She would do the commission retreat first, and then the management trainings and the strategic planning would fold in after that.
Great. So I think that the question here is, we've been talking about having a board training, a commission training, and to train the commission what it means to be a commissioner. And we're woefully behind on that. And is this person, is that in her venue to do that?
Yes, it is.
Okay. And so I would push for the strategic planning to have it at all the branches, yes. But also for this, not so much for strategic planning, but for board training. And so if we can make that clear, I would vote for this tonight, but if we can make that clear to the consultant, this is not strategic planning for the commission. It's for commission training to get us all up to snuff and on the same page. So.
Okay, I saw a hand down there. It's Stephen.
Yes, I mean, if I'm going to vote for this, I would like an addendum or it to be clear if we're going to direct our director to direct them that there needs to be a proposed agenda provided to all of our commissioners at least 48 hours before we're expected to show up and to invite our input into the proposed agenda. Because I'm telling you, I am not going to show up if I don't have any buy-in as far as how I'm going to spend my entire day. It's not going to happen.
Tom.
I've been here for 2 years and I've been through at least two board training things, and mostly it was a waste of time. Maybe we did three. We did one ourselves and you kept really good notes, Reese. That one was the best one. So I'm cynical. And so that's where I'm coming from.
Okay. Barbara?
Well, you know, let's go back to what Paul said. Paul said we need training of how we are commissioners. What's it like to be a commissioner? What are the roles? What are the responsibilities? Very, very specific. We haven't ever really trained in that. I've tried to get consultants to work with us for 3 years, and I'm always outvoted. But I also am concerned. I don't want to come and have like team building exercises and, you know, that kind of general stuff. I want some very specific training about our specific JPA, our specific roles and responsibilities. We're very different than anybody else, and we don't necessarily, we're not all necessarily on board with that. So I agree about having an agenda, and I'm wondering, rather than having her write the agenda, we write the agenda. I mean, we need to talk about what we, you know, we need to tell her what we need. So,
Anne?
Yes, I agree, definitely. When I spoke with her the other day, we talked about the format and the content for the commission retreat, and her plan is to address it from roles and responsibilities, the law, looking at it that way, not in terms of team building. We're not going to do the you know, kumbaya stuff. It's going to be very strict in roles and responsibilities legally and as a governing board.
Okay. Andy?
Anne, just to clarify, and maybe I'm misinterpreting what I'm reading, are you saying that what appears on page 162 as the commission retreat would actually be the training session that you're describing and not a retreat to gather our input for the strategic plan?
No, this is ahead of the strategic plan. This is the commission retreat to talk about roles and responsibilities. Then we'll do the retreat for OMT to talk about our roles and responsibilities and team building for our group. Then we go into strategic planning. So there will be more focus groups with the commission and with other groups at that point. But this is ahead of the strategic plan.
Thank you.
Deborah, did you have a question or comment?
This is just sort of a detail thing, but if we're going to ask a consultant to do twice as many branches, then we're probably going to have to increase the dollar figure that we spend. And so, okay.
We can consider that. What I was thinking was that once we've had some experience with her and with how we can best approach these focus groups in the locations, she doesn't need to do all of them. We can divide that up. She can do a train the trainer, and then we can handle part of that ourselves.
Okay, that's good. Good use of it. Yep. David?
Yeah, I wouldn't go so far as to say that the commissioner trainee will necessarily be useless. But I am concerned that there's a high useless coefficient built in. We're already in business. All of us have been doing this for a minimum of 7 months without amazing foul-ups. And so I hope that perhaps the commissioner training could be somewhat stripped down. I mean, I've even read the JPA three times.
Okay. Any, Deborah?
I think we need board effectiveness training. I think that we have not worked together as a board for very long, and I think that we have a lot of energy, but we are sending a lot of energy in a lot of different directions. And I think it would be wonderful if we took a look at vision and took a look at how we want to use this energy instead of herring off in 11 different directions, even if it's only slightly different directions, and then have the staff try to corral us back into order. So I believe it's important, and I've been giving board effectiveness trainings for 15 years. I'm not volunteering to do it, God knows, but they're incredibly important, especially for smart, driven people who may not know as much about the library as they think they do.
Okay.
Yes, I second what Commissioner Doyle just said.
Okay, so do I hear a motion to approve this agreement with Library Solutions, providing we can work out a way to handle the 14 libraries? Does that sound?
I so move.
Well, with a friendly amendment and with a clarification of the commissioner training as stated by our director.
Oh, and with a further understanding that we'll get agendas ahead of time.
Did you get all that? And that's okay? Okay. Okay, so it's been moved. Do we have a second?
Second.
Cahill's a second. Barbara was the move. So all those in favor of
Excuse me, was Paul not made the move?
Public comment? There isn't anybody?
I made the motion.
I believe
you
Paul made the motion.
Okay, Paul made the motion. Sorry. I thought Barbara did.
That's all right.
I amended it.
You amended it. Okay. And David seconded. Oh, gosh. Okay. So all those in favor of this, huh? I said public comment, and there's no public in here. So I didn't dwell on it. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All those against? Passed unanimously. Okay, moving on to director's report. Thank you, everybody. Moving on to director's report.
All right, well, the highlight of my month of July was the first Meet the Director that we held at Roseland with about 42 very enthusiastic community members. I'll be doing these once a month, rotating around the locations. The next one will be this week, Wednesday night at Sonoma Valley. And otherwise, I mean, the rest of my activities are noted here. I would like to take a moment to point out a few things from the management report. So, back here. which I've just misplaced, but I'm coming. 175. Yep, thank you. Right. So here it is. All right. So to call out a couple of our staff members, John Haupt, the branch manager for Healdsburg, was selected for the Daily Acts Leadership Institute, which is a great thing. We're really proud of him for that. And as previously mentioned, Sebastopol librarian Rosalie Abbott won the 2019 California Library Association's Youth Services Award, and she will be recognized at the CLA conference later this month, in the fall. Jackie Martinez of Petaluma did a presentation about the library at the JobLinks staff day, and she said that one person mentioned they felt they'd been asleep for 30 years and didn't know that the library was this cool, and they were excited to start going again. So that's a wonderful thing. In youth services, we've been all about summer reading, but a couple of other things that have been happening that I think are worth mentioning. A new project called Stories to Go. That's a themed bilingual story time kit that we check out to daycare and childcare centers. And it will include librarian visits to model using the materials to conduct a meaningful story time on site. We're going to launch the pilot of this program in August at Rohnert Park, Roseland, Sonoma Valley, and Windsor. And then also, as another really fun thing coming up, our library has been selected as one of 13 locations nationally to host amateur radio contact with the International Space Station. So that's just amazing. Our contact will be sometime between September 30th and October 6th. We don't know the exact date yet, but of course we're planning all kinds of wonderful space-themed programming around that. So we'll let you know as soon as we have more details.
Excuse me, Anne, is that going to go through Central, or who's going to be in the lead on that?
I can.
Central, yes.
Yeah, it's going to be at Central Library, and we've already checked out the telecom and everything. The guy's a ham radio operator. We've got everything all arranged. We're really looking forward to seeing how it happens.
If you would let the commission know, especially me, I'd be really like to be part of that.
Yeah, that's great. And it'll be happening in the Central Forum Room, and I forget September 30th, but we'll find out for you, okay?
Okay. Anything else, Ann?
Okay. That's it.
What about the financial report? Who's giving that?
Well, Renee is unable to be with us tonight, so the financial report is in your packet, and as Commissioner Neff has already pointed out, we will have a surplus this year, so we're working on ideas for that, and we'll bring some a list of opportunities to the Finance Committee next month.
Okay.
Your question, Reese.
Okay, Jason.
I was looking at our little brochure, and it says financial summary on the back, Sonoma County Library. And on here, am I missing something? It shows projected expenses at $36.2 million, and revenue at $32.9 million, and then we have a surplus.
Don't ask me.
So I'm just trying to understand the differences between.
Randall.
Projected. 1920, for next year?
No, these are the same period.
Okay, what happens is we started in February and we asked the county property tax guys, what's their projection for property tax? And we do our budget based on that. For the past number of years, they have been conservative and we have gotten more revenue. Okay? Then we put in the budget. The second thing is we start out and we add all these staff positions at the beginning of the year, but it takes a long time to fill them. Plus, there's some expenses in there that are overestimated. So we spend less than we've budgeted. So the two of those add up. We spend less than we budgeted. We get in more revenue than we budget.
Yeah, but that's not what this says.
You know, I understand that, but that's not what this says. 2 years in a row, we've been running with surpluses, and this shows this shows a deficit. And I'm just curious as to why suddenly, after 2 years of surplus, we're running a deficit on the third year. But that's to be determined later.
I think there is something wrong with this.
Yeah.
Right.
Thank you, Chair Fox and Commissioners Ray Hawley. I put that information together, and the budget numbers are the budget that you adopted a few months ago, and the expenses reflect use of surplus. And as Commissioner Neff pointed out, there are best estimate based on the rolling revenue and expenses.
I know. Typically, over the last few years, too, 1 year they predicted we get, this was before the fires, they predicted we would get 5%, and we ended up getting 7.5%. Another time we were supposed to get 3%, and we got 5%. So there's always that edge, and I think that we have budgeted to the edge as well as some of the other things. So, does that help? Ray, I mean, Dave.
Yeah, I must. I cannot fail to point out that according to this sheet, financial summary, 2019 to 2020 projected revenue is roughly $33 million. 2019 to 2020 projected expenses is $36 million. I don't think this accurately reflects what we've been told in our financial reports. It just is not correct, according to my view. Or the financial reports that are in this packet. That's all.
It reflects the budget numbers that you adopted a couple of months ago.
If I may, we have more expenditure than we have revenue because we have carryover from past years that we're projecting we're going to spend during this year. That's why we're $3 million more expense than we have revenue. So yes. You've got to, you know, the income is the 33. There's no question about that. It's the revenue, the expense is the 33 we budgeted to spend, plus about $3 million left over carryover. Now, I think it's misleading. It's probably not a good idea, but it.
All right.
It's also the case that we budgeted over $1 million for the Petaluma refresh last year, and we spent a tiny amount on it. But we're still looking at this $1 million plus in Petaluma, but it's money from last year.
And it's money that's sitting there waiting to be spent.
Waiting to be spent.
Yeah.
Barbara?
And I remember this is something that happens pretty much every year. Along with a change in how much we get. So, does that help?
Well, I think just the confusing part is that if you're a member of the public and you just looked and you're getting, you know, 32.9 in and you're gonna spend 36.2, in parentheses, it does say includes carryover from the prior. But I mean, it sounds a little, I don't know, I'm not gonna argue the point. But I do wanna say something about the financial reports, which I think if I don't say it now, we're gonna adjourn. Commissioner Neff said, we didn't have the Finance Committee report the meeting last month. We didn't have these reports. I am sure not the only one who was going to ask some questions at our next Finance Committee meeting. We're talking about a $241,000 outside legal. I'm assuming a large part of that was labor negotiated. But anyway, there's a lot of questions that I have on here when we've exceeded, well exceeded 100% of our budget amounts, like by 1,252% and 700% and stuff. So anyway, I just want to go on record that I have this interest in clarification of a lot of the items that are on this finance report. Normally, the finance committee meets, goes through everything, and then comes to the commission. This one, because it was a timing issue and closing out the year, we were not able to do that, but I'm sure we were going to look at a lot of these things. If you have any questions about the finance committee, right? Chair, Mr. Neff. I'm sure you agree. Any, thank you.
Any other comments? Randall, you're scooting forward.
It's unfortunate we did not have the meeting. We will review it very carefully with our CFO.
Okay, anything else? All righty, moving on. Agenda items for future commission meetings. Tom, your hand's going up.
We had that all day lab meeting, and that's been a couple of months, and I'd like to know what's going on about that.
Okay. We will clarify.
I will second that. And also I want to hear about from somebody in reference to the archives. Where are we with that?
All righty. Archives and the all-day lab. What else?
That
Dave?
Closed session hanging over on the retirement issue.
Oh, we'll take care of that. We'll take care of that.
Sorry, taking care of.
We'll take care of it. Yeah, okay. Working down the line, Stephen. Jason?
A Roseland update on the new temporary lease. Where it stands, when we expect to move in there, just an update.
Yes.
On the Roseland project in and of itself, kind of.
I don't necessarily need the where we stand with the whole capital campaign, I don't think.
Not that, but
no,
getting into the library.
I want it to know the new 6 month, this new 6 year lease I think we have with location across the street.
Okay.
Yes, second that. Thank you, Jason.
Anything else? All righty. We're done with that. Date and time of next meeting, September 9th, 6 p.m. here in the City Council Chambers of Santa Rosa. And I am adjourning the meeting.